is to preach the word. I'm going to be speaking. Last week we talked about glorying in Christ's death and the cross. This morning I want to talk about the redemption by Christ's blood. Redemption by Christ's blood. We have in your seat John MacArthur's Heresy in the Blood of Christ. We'll be referring to that a little bit later, from pages 44 to 48. But let's begin by reading verse number Ephesians 1. Yeah. Well, we don't have that before, so I guess I'd rather read that. Let's see. Let's just begin by, this is a prison epistle. This is a prison letter written to four, when Paul was in prison, in four different churches he writes to. And the reason he's in prison is because he, first of all, appealed to Caesar. Well, thanks, Dan. We can read this, I guess, a little bit later. We have read it already, so it would be all right. Thank you. He was in prison because they were going to release him, but his eye appealed to Caesar. He was in there wrong, and he wanted to be sure that everything was right. That's why he's in prison. And then Caesar, for instance, in Acts 25, in verse 11, he says, if I'm an offender, it's fine, but I appeal unto Caesar. Again, in Acts 28, verse 19, but when the Jews speak against it, I was constrained to appeal unto Caesar, and that I had might to accuse my nation. So, he's appealed to Caesar because he didn't think he got the right actions from the Jews that hated the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a number of references in these four prison epistles. You have Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians, and Philemon. And there's references, not too many, but references that he's in bonds and a prisoner. For example, in Ephesians 3:1, this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ. He's not a prisoner for doing something that's evil, but because he preached Christ, and they hated that. Ephesians 4:1, again, I, the prisoner of the Lord. Ephesians 6:19, to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which cause I am an ambassador in bonds. Because he preached the gospel, he's an ambassador in bonds. And then the second prison letter that he wrote, not only Ephesians, but Philippians. Philippians also mentioned he was a prisoner. Philippians 1 and verse 7, for example. both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. Bonds, but defense of the gospel and confirmation, preaching it as well as defending it. Then also in Philippians 1 and verse 14, he says, many of the brethren in the Lord waxing confident in my bonds, so much more bold to preach the gospel. So again, in his bonds, being in prison in Rome. Then again, Philippians 1, 16, I preach Christ not of contention, but sincerely, sincerely, supposed to add affliction to my bonds. Again, the bonds. Then the third letter that he wrote while being a prisoner in Rome was Colossians. There are several verses on that. He remembers that. Colossians 4, verse 3. He says, with all praying also for us, that God would open up for us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. For the mystery of Christ, preaching Christ, that's what put him in jail. Nothing, not because he was evil. Then Colossians 4, verse 18. The salutation of the hand by my hand, remember my bonds. He asked prayer for those in Colossians, remember his bonds. Then the book of Philemon, another prison epistle he wrote from jail. Philemon, verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Prisoner because of the preaching of Christ. That's why he was in jail. Philemon verse 9. Yet for love's sake I rather beseech thee, being such as one as Paul the aged, now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Again, he always links those two things. And also Philemon verse 10. I beseech thee for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my bonds. He led Onesimus to Christ while he was in jail there in Rome. All right, now let's read Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 1 together. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. He's writing, but notice, he's an apostle by Jesus Christ. Onesimus, not Onesimus, but Matthias was an apostle by the ones that were the apostles. They had an election, great election. They had two people in the election. They drew lots, and one lot fell under Matthias, and so he was named by the apostles as an apostle to take the place of Judas. But Paul was not an apostle by the apostles. As he says in verse 1, he's an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. The Lord himself, when he was converted on the road to Damascus, he named him as an apostle and referred to him as an apostle, and he took the place of that traitor, Judas Iscariot. And he's writing to the saints, the believers which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, all the ones that are faithful, genuinely saved Christians, he's writing that as well. Let's read verse number 2 together. Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace is the greeting to the Greeks. Grace, charis. They always greet people by grace, getting something we don't deserve. And then this word peace, that's the greeting for the Jews. Shalom, that's what they say all the time. Shalom, shalom, shalom. And notice the greetings of both grace and peace to the Gentiles as well as to the Jews who are in Christ. It's from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now God the Father and God the Son are co-equal. They're eternal. They're fine. They're creators of the ends of the earth. They're not simply creatures. Now some heresy, some people think they're just Lord Jesus was a creature. That's blanket heresy from the pit of hell. He's the creator, and he's noticed he's yoked with the Father and the Holy Spirit. He's a member of the Trinity, who always, from everlasting to everlasting, were here. Let's read verse number 3 together. Blessed be God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. And notice, blessed be God the Father, again, Father and the Son, co-equal from eternity past to eternity future, and creators of heaven and earth. Notice, he says he has blessed us who are genuine Christians, not unsaved people, but blessed us. Now imagine how he could write this when he was in chains in the Roman prison. He's thinking of the blessings of God, blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. So it was true, he was in prison, that certainly isn't a blessed place, but we're blessed in Christ if we're genuine Christians. With all spiritual blessings, notice where the blessings are, in heavenly places in Christ. The heavenly places in the Lord Jesus Christ. In Ephesians 1 and verse 20, for example, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. That's speaking of heaven itself, the heaven of heavens. And so he's blessed the believers in heavenly blessings as well. In Ephesians 2 and verse 6, he's blessed us up, raised us up together, those that are genuine Christians, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So even though the genuine Christians are here on earth, as far as God is concerned, we also are with him in heavenly places right now, receiving blessings from the Father and from the Son. And then in Ephesians 3 and verse 10, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God. The powers in heavenly places. God is a power. He's in heavenly places. Not the earthly power of presidents or governors or mayors or any sorts of powers, but heavenly powers in Christ Jesus. Let's read verse number 4 together. According as he hath abounded in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be truly without blame before in love. Now this chosenness in him before the foundation of the world. Many hyper-Calvinists take this that they're chosen, just elect, and that's it. I take the position of corporate election. Corporate, a whole body. I believe God in the heaven, he created a body of Christ consisting of all those that genuinely trust him as Savior and Redeemer. And then the body of Christ is in heavenly places, and all those that are genuinely saved, will be genuinely saved, are made a part of that body of Christ. When we receive Christ as our Savior, we're a part of that body, which is from all eternity. And that's the position that I take. I think it's clear that the Lord has given us a body, and when we're saved, we're part of that body, which before the foundation of the world was put in there. And the purpose of being chosen by him, putting that in heavenly places, is that we should be holy. Genuine Christians should be holy. A lot of Christians are not holy. It's a sad thing. They're not unsaved, but they live for the flesh, for the world, for the devil, not for the Lord. Now, will they be taken into heaven? Yes. Once God regenerates their hearts, no matter what they do or don't do, they're saved. But if they live for their flesh, they're carnal Christians, horrible, disgraceful Christians. God is not pleased with such carnality. But they will take them to heaven nonetheless if they're genuinely trusting the Savior by faith. But shows us in Matthew 13:35, says that it might be fulfilled. The Lord Jesus has spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. Different places, the foundation of the world, the beginning of the world. And then in Matthew 25:34, the Lord Jesus said, Then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. There's a kingdom prepared. He knew all about it. Does God know in advance, before we've been born, that either we'll accept the Lord Jesus, our Savior, or not? Yes, He knows. And those that have accepted Him, they've already been placed, those that have trusted Christ, in the body of Christ. Very important that we see that. And then in Luke 11, verse 50, that the blood of all the prophets, which was shed from the foundation of the world, may be required of this generation. Now, how can the blood of the prophets who lived in time be saying that their blood was shed from the foundation of the world? It's because God knows all things. He knows He's going to be killed and blood has been shed. It's shed as far as God is concerned from eternity, even though it's shed in time. Then John 17, verse 24. Father, he's praying to the Father now. It's a high priestly prayer of the Lord, John 15:17. I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. From eternity past, the Father loved the Son. In Hebrews 4 and verse 3, he says, that which have they we who have believed do enter into rest. He said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. God is, He knows the end from the beginning. He knows all about it. And people haven't been born, but those that are saved, the Lord knew about it from the foundation of the world. In Hebrews 9:26, then must He often have suffered, that is the Lord Jesus, since the foundation of the world. But now once in the end of the world hath He appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of Himself. The Father knew the Son was going to suffer and die from the foundation of the world, before the world was even constructed or born or made. But at the time, He appeared and put away the sacrifice, put away sin by the sacrifice of Himself. Then in 1 Peter 1 and verse 20, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. The Father knew from the foundation of the world that He was going to come, ordained, foreordained. But He came. Then in Revelation 13, verse 8, all that dwell upon the earth shall worship Him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. All that dwell upon the earth shall worship Him, whose names are not written. Should be written. It must be a mistake. Who are written in the book of life. Who are not written? False people, I guess.
False Christ.
Worship Him, that is the Antichrist, yes, whose names are not written, yes. From the Lamb, now notice the Lamb is slain for the foundation of the world. From eternity, God is considered to be slain, but He was slain in time. Again, God knows the end from the beginning. Revelation 17, verse 8, the beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they which dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. Again, God knows who's going to be saved. And from the foundation of the world, He knew the names that were not written. Then we who have been saved are to be holy. In Leviticus 20, verse 7, God says, Sanctify yourselves, therefore. Be ye holy, For I, the Lord, your God, I am the Lord your God. Then in 1 Peter 1:15, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, all manner of life. We should be holy. We can't possibly be as holy as God, but we got to aim at it. And if we aim at nothing, you know, you'll reach it and hit it every time. We've got to aim to be holy, following the Scriptures, following the Lord. Then, because, as it is written, be holy because I am holy. And then let's read verse number 5 together. Having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. Predestinated us from the adoption of children. He knew ahead of time who would be saved and trust Christ. And so that's a thing. In Romans 8:29, for example, this word predestination is used. For whom he did foreknow, God knows everything ahead of time, he also did predestinate. What does he predestinate in this verse? To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. The predestination is every genuine saved Christian is to one day be conformed to the image of his Son, with new bodies like unto Christ. That's a definite future promise. That's the end, and that's the goal in this verse of predestination. In Romans 8:30, moreover, whom he did predestinate, and them he also called, whom he called, he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. And we know that one. Then in Ephesians 1:11, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Then, because we've been praised, become Christians in general, faith in Christ, genuine Christians, we've received what he calls here the adoption. That means full-grown sons. Once we've been genuine Christians, already full-grown, adoption. We're in the family. In Romans 8:15, for example, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we call Abba, Father. He's our Father. Genuine Christians have God the Father. Those that are not Christians, genuine Christians, have the devil as their father. The devil is their father, and they don't know it, but the devil is. As it says in John 8:44, very clear, your father the devil. Lord Jesus told the Pharisees, ye are of your father the devil. And those that reject Christ are not genuinely saved, devil is their father. And they do devilish deeds as well. Then in verse number 6, let's read verse number 6 together. To the price of the glory of his grace, wherein he had made us accepted in the beloved. Accepted in the beloved. The beloved is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's, by the way, in the perfect tense. It's something that is transpired in the past, results continue in the present into the future. We've been accepted in the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Those who are genuine Christians. And it's by the praise of his glory, and we should praise the Lord and thank the Lord for this. Let's read verse number 7 together. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Okay, now take out your John MacArthur's Heresy, the Book of the Blood of Christ, if you wish, and follow along. Turn to page 44. Page 44 to 48, we list 14 things that John MacArthur thinks are not right. They're biblical effects of the literal blood of Christ. Now, John MacArthur is a heretic on this and many other things. You'll see in the early part of this book, John MacArthur's Heresy of the Blood, other false teachings. But he is a great influence in this country and all around the world. He's got a church up there. He's got a seminary, a college. He's got internets. He's got all over the world. And he's teaching this heresy in the blood of Christ. John MacArthur says, the blood doesn't mean blood. It means the death of Christ. That's all. No, if someone just believes in the death of Christ, that he died somewhere, they're lost, bound for hell. He shed his blood at his death. But if you don't predicate that the Savior's blood is what saves, you're lost. So what does that make MacArthur? I don't know. All of his teachers, his followers, all of them say the same heretical thing. Now, there's very clear scripture, rule of Bible interpretation, I mean, and this interpretation is very clear. It's in one of our Defined King James Bible's pages, and is when The plain sense of Scripture makes common sense. Seek no other sense. Therefore, take every word at its primary, ordinary, unusual, usual, literal meaning, unless the facts of the immediate context, studied in the light of related passages and axiomatic and fundamental truths, indicate clearly otherwise. God, in revealing His Word, neither intends nor permits the reader to be confused. He wants the children to understand. And that's what MacArthur has done with his changing of the word blood, haima, to the word thanatos, which is death. Here's some of the verses. There are a total of 14 different passages, 14 different failings and effects of the blood of Christ that MacArthur does not agree with. The first, you notice that we've been redemption, atonement, substitution, remission, salvation, or purchase through the literal blood of Christ. It's clear in Scripture. Just to give you a verse, Leviticus 17:11, for example. Let's say it together. For the life of the flesh is in the blood there, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh atonement for the soul. The blood, not simply the death. In His death, He shed His blood. It's very important. The same was in Matthew 26 and Mark 14 and Luke 22 and Acts 20, verse 28. Let's read that together. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which He hath purchased with His own blood. The Father had the special, when He gave the incarnation to make the Lord Jesus perfect God and perfect man, He gave Him a body that was prepared by the Lord. It says in the book of Hebrews, a sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. Now in the body you have the blood, the arms, the hands, the hair, every part, the legs. Every part of the Lord Jesus' body, including His blood, was divine. It was from God. That's what this verse is teaching here. And the blood of God, purchased with His own blood, and the blood of God. And so the literal blood of Christ is done all. For instance, in the next one, Romans 5, verse 9, let's read that one. Much more then, being now justified by His blood, we should be saved from wrath through Him. All these things are clear indications of the Scripture. And let's read also 1 Peter 1:18 together. For as much as ye know that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but by the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish, without Christ. It's in the blood of God, the blood that's not that's fallible, but infallible by the Lord. And notice the second thing on your page, the second thing that is given to us by the literal blood of Christ. We have propitiation through the literal blood of Christ, not by just His death at all. Let's read together Romans 3:25. When God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins which are past through the forbearance of God. The literal blood of Christ gives us that redemption. And then let's say the third thing together. We have justification through the literal blood of Christ. Justification. Not only these other things that I mentioned, this is the third literal blood of Christ that's given to us. We have justification. Let's read Romans 5, verse 9. Much more then, being justified by His blood, we should be saved from wrath through Him. Not justified by His death. How can MacArthur and his followers, his thousands and thousands of followers, take a simple word, blood, haima is a Greek word, and transform it to the word death? See, thanatos, completely different. When the words make common sense, seek no other sense, that's a literal interpretation of Scripture should be taken that way. Let's read the third one is we have justification. And the fourth one is we have fellowship through the Lord Jesus Christ, the literal blood of Christ. Fellowship, believe. Let's read verse Ephesians 2:13. But now in Christ Jesus, you who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Made nigh, close, by the blood, not His death. Now, there's a man that was on the radio for many years. He was one of the presidents of Dallas Theological Seminary after different ones died. What's his name? John? What's his last name?
Wolverd.
No, the other one that took his place. Yeah. Anyway, one time on a broadcast, he's on the radio many times. Was it?
Chuck Swindoll.
Chuck Swindoll, that's right. It was Chuck. Chuck Swindoll. He was on the radio. I listened to him very carefully. And he was saying, he quoted a scripture, and he left off by the blood of Christ. He left off. Then he wrote a letter one time. And because someone asked him, why do you not believe in the blood of Christ? And the answer came back that agreed with MacArthur. And so it exposed it. Then later on, what's his name, Dan?
Swindoll.
He wrote to the whole people, said, well, I don't agree, this was my fault, he did it by mistake. But he had people in his program, on his staff, that believe with MacArthur, it's the death, but not the blood of Christ. It's interesting indeed. And then the fifth thing we have peace through the literal blood of Christ. Let's read Colossians 1:20. And having made, Colossians 1:20, for the fifth thing, having made peace through the blood of his cross, he reconciled all things to himself. I say, will they be things in heaven or things on earth? He made peace through the blood of his Christ. Colossians. Then also the sixth thing. We have forgiveness through the literal blood of Christ. Let's read verse Ephesians 1:7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. That's what we read this morning. It's part of our preaching tour. And then we have also in Colossians 1:14 through the blood, both Ephesians and Colossians we have. And then the seventh thing we have by the literal blood of Christ, we have sanctification through the literal blood of Christ. It's written in Hebrews 13:12. Let's read this one together. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might save them from blood, suffered from Africa, that he might sanctify the people, set them apart through his blood, not his death. I think that man that wrote Swindoll's man, he said as far as he believes, he could be saved just like animals are slain. That's all. That's all he said. Horrible. I'm glad that Swindoll corrected him, but he had that man. And that's what these people believe is a terrible thing. So that's sanctification. Then notice the eighth thing. We have reconciliation through the literal blood of Christ. Let's read Colossians 1:20. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, and him reconciled all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things on earth or things in heaven. Reconciliation, not by his death alone, the shedding of his blood. You know, the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, the Passover lamb, when God delivered his people from Egypt, there were two things that had to be done. They had to take a lamb, they had to make sure, look at it for 5 or 6 or 10 days, whatever, make sure it's complete and holy and perfect. Then take that lamb and slay that lamb. Then after the death of the lamb, they're taking a second thing. Take that lamb's blood. Death and blood. God doesn't ever mix them together. You slay the lamb, take the lamb's blood, and then put it on the top and side post of the door. When I see the blood, not the death of the lamb, when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
Amen.
I'll pass over you. Very important indeed. And then in the ninth thing, we have cleansing through the blood of Christ, purging and washing and purifying. Let's read Hebrews 9:14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Purge, cleanse, wash. It washes the blood of Christ. Then notice the tenth thing, at the bottom of the page, the tenth thing, we have remembrance through the literal blood of Christ. Let's read 1 Corinthians 11:25. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye think it, in remembrance of me. Now we're remembering his blood. We remember the death, but it's the blood we're to remember. The blood of Christ is remembrance as well. Then the 11th thing we have boldness and access to God through the Lord Jesus' blood. Let's read Hebrews 10:19 together. Having therefore boldness, holiness by the blood of Jesus. Boldness to enter the blood. We have boldness through his blood. Then notice The 12th thing we have with the blood, we have maturity, grown upness through the blood. Let's read Matthew, or here rather Hebrews 13:20. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. So it's through the everlasting covenant we have maturity. Let's read Hebrews 13:20 on the rest of the verse, 21. Make you perfect in every good work to do His will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Yes, maturity make us perfect, grown up, mature through the blood of Christ. And then the 13th thing we have in the blood of Christ, we have punishment or weakness or sickness or death if we mistreat the literal blood of Christ. Let's read First Corinthians 11:27. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup, Lord, unworthily, shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. And then read also 1 Corinthians 11:29. He that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation himself, not discerning the Lord's body. 1 Corinthians 1:3. Many sleep. That means sleep and death. They misuse the Lord's Supper. They take it. They're unsaved. They're lost. They take the Lord's Supper. Many of them were killed by the Lord because it was the dishonest way to do it. And that's a very important thing. It brings judgment and punishment if it's not done properly. And then finally, the 14th thing we have victory over Satan through the literal blood of Christ. Let's read Revelation 12:11. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of his servant. And they love not their lives unto the death. These are 14 things in Scripture, very clear, that we have through the blood of Christ. And John MacArthur says, none of these things we have through the blood of Christ, not a single thing, just by his death. But in this verse of 1 Corinthians, Ephesians 1 and verse 7, we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of sins. There are many verses on forgiveness, but through his blood we have forgiveness. Now, if it's not through the blood, apparently there's no forgiveness. That seems to be... And so, if this is the verse that's true, and we believe it is, only through the blood of Christ, genuine Christians have forgiveness. If they despise the blood of Christ, they set it not the blood of Christ, say that's nothing, it's no good, it's not the important thing, do they have forgiveness? That's the question. Do they have forgiveness? MacArthur, who throws away the blood of Christ that brings forgiveness, does he have it? I don't know. But you mean, we kind of wonder about it. The Scriptures are clear that through the blood of Christ, in whom we have redemption, through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Only through his blood. Well, the verse is on forgiveness, but in Acts 5, verse 31, him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. The Lord Jesus Christ alone can give forgiveness of sins. In Acts 13:38, be it known unto you, brethren, that through this man, through the Lord Jesus, preached unto thee, you have forgiveness of sins. Only through the Lord Jesus Christ and through his blood. Then in Acts 26 and verse 18, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God. This is Paul's commission, what he was to do when he met the Lord Jesus on that road. That they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them that are sanctified. Paul was to make sure as he preached the gospel, people would have forgiveness of sins. Then in Romans 4 and verse 7, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven, whose sins are covered. There's the blessedness, there's the happiness, there's the joy of sins forgiven by genuine faith in Christ Jesus. Then in Ephesians 4:32, be kind one to another. Maybe we know this. Tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. So forgiving other believers. Do other believers sometimes sin against the fellow believers? Yes, they do. What happens? What does God say to them? Forgive them if they say that they know what they're... Now, you can't forgive them if they don't think they've done anything wrong, but you forgive them. We hope that they agree. I made this mistake, and forgiving one another as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Then Colossians 1:14, we already read, we have redemption through his blood. And then, now, if the redemption is through his blood, And John MacArthur and his followers, many thousands and thousands who follow him, don't believe anything about the blood. Do they have redemption? I don't know. God knows. I'm just asking. I wonder about it. A serious wonder. Then Colossians 2 and verse 13. You being dead in your sins, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, with the Lord Jesus, having forgiven you all trespasses. Forgiveness. And then 1 John 1:9, we know that one, let's say it. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now we said many times before that word confess. What's that Greek word? Homologeo. Homo is same. Logeo is to say. Say the same thing about our sins as God says. To agree with God that we're sinners. And we confess, that means we agree with God. If we don't agree with God, if we don't think the sins that we committed are sins, does God forgive us? I don't think he does. Confess first. That means I agree with you, Lord. I've sinned. I've done this and this and this. I agree with you. Then and only then will he forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And for people just mouthing the words, but don't believe that we've sinned and we don't agree with God. It's sin what we've done. He does not forgive us. Very important. Forgiveness. And then in 1 John 2 and verse 12, I write unto you little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. Very important, is it not? And let's read verse number 8. Wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Speaking of genuine Christians who are forgiven, and they, wherein this forgiveness, because of the forgiveness, God has abounded toward us, those are genuine Christians, in wisdom and prudence. And we have the wisdom, God's wisdom, in his word, the scriptures, the Bible, the right Bible, not the wrong Bibles, but the right Bible, all of God's wisdom that he wants us to know and to have, he's given to us, and prudence, wisdom, the right use of that wisdom indeed as well. Let's read verse number 9 together. Having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure which he has bounded himself. And he's made unto us his will. Again, we always said many times, full knowledge of his will is found in full knowledge of his words. And we've got to know the words of God. That's where his will is. He's made known unto us. Now, unsaved people cannot understand and know the words of God. They can read them, and they can read what English means, or Spanish, or French, or German, whatever language they have. They can't really understand them until the Holy Spirit brings them to light. It's through the Holy Spirit of God that makes things understood in the Scriptures. But he's made unto us his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself. For his will is in his words, and God the Holy Spirit helps us and teaches us. He's our teacher to know what that word means and what that word is all about. Let's read verse number 10 together. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, which are in heaven, which are on earth, even in him. One day after the Lord is finished with this earth, this says fullness of times, God's going to gather together those that are genuinely saved in this earth. They're going to be gathered together and taken to heaven. Those that are in heaven in glory, they're going to be joined with those in heaven. Those that are in earth, they're taken to heaven. They will be made one, even in him. There's going to be a universal gathering together of the saints of God, those that are still living, and God will take them to heaven at the end of the age, end of the earth, after the millennial reign of Christ, gather together with those genuine Christians that are in heaven, so it'll be one in Christ, one body, together. Right now, we don't have them all together. We have genuine Christians on earth, genuine Christians are in heaven. We're not together, they're up there, and we're down here. But one day, we're going to be gathered together, all together, in one holy body. Let's read verse number 11 together. In whom also ye have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his will. Speaking of being in Christ, in whom we that as genuine Christians have obtained an inheritance. Now maybe your mom and dad who've died, or grandmother, grandparents, or whatever, maybe your parents haven't died yet, maybe they didn't leave you any inheritance. We don't know what inheritance may come our way after the death of our parents or grandparents or other people, but if we're saved and genuine Christians, in Christ, we have an inheritance that for sure doesn't waver. Nobody can steal it from us. We've got it. We ought to be glad for that. We ought to be thankful that we are in Him and saved and one of His children. Having predestinated according to the purpose of Him, He's known in advance. He's made it sure once we're saved, we have that insurance, the purpose of will that worketh all things after the counsel of His will. God has us eternal purpose and eternal inheritance with Him. It's already known in advance. It's already put down. Now, we don't know what it is yet. We haven't experienced it. The Lord has told us what our inheritance is. There's some verses on inheritance. For instance, Acts 20 and verse 32. Paul said, "Now, there, brethren, I commend you to God and the word of His grace is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified." God has promised, once we're genuine Christians and saved, to give us an inheritance, and nobody's going to take it away from us. From all those that are sanctified. Then in Acts 26, in verse 18, Paul was given this, when his conversion, to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among all them that are sanctified through faith that is in Him. Lord Jesus was very clear that genuine Christians that are saved have an inheritance. No matter what you do down on earth or not, there's an inheritance for those that are genuinely saved and sanctified and holy as they can be and are walking with the Lord. I believe there's also an inheritance for those that are saved, born again, but they're carnal. They walk according to their flesh. They're going to be taken to heaven if they're just genuinely trusting our Savior. But I think their inheritance won't be quite as glossy or quite as the same as those who are walking with the Lord. As we see at the judgment seat of Christ, some build on hay, wood, and stubble, which burns away and is gone and big. Some Christians build with gold, silver, and precious stones, which is small but very valuable. There will be a gradation inheritance once we reach, get to glory. And we're still saved. We don't lose salvation. The carnal Christian is not going to be losing salvation. But he will use, or she will use, their rewards. Lose their rewards in heaven. Ephesians 1:14 talks about inheritance, which is the earnest of our inheritance, unto the redemption of the purchased possession, and the praise of His glory. An earnest is a down payment, and it's down payment that has been given. So in Ephesians 1:18, riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. Colossians 1:12. Hath made us to be meet to be partakers of the inheritance of all the saints on high. He's made us fitting to be given that inheritance. Colossians 3:24, the reward of the inheritance. Hebrews 9:15, the promise of eternal inheritance. We have it, it's a promise. And 1 Peter 1:4, we have to an inheritance, incorruptible and undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Those genuine Christians have an inheritance. Then let's read verse number 12 together. That we should be to the praise of His glory who first trusted in Christ. Once we have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ and are saved by faith in the resurrection, by the faith in His blood of Christ, then we have the obligation to be to the praise of His glory. That's why He saved us, who first trusted in Christ. And that's an important thing. Praise of His glory, not the glory of ourselves, not the glory of other people or parents or other preachers or pastors or whatever, but the praise of His glory. God wants us praising Him. He wants us to glorify Him as well. Let's close in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank and praise Thee for the book of Ephesians. Paul, being in prison, wrote these wonderful words to us, the saved. Different imprisonments, but Ephesians and Ephesus was one, as well as the other three. We thank Thee that he talked about the Lord Jesus and His precious blood that sanctifies and saves and gives us forgiveness and inheritance. We pray for those who may be saved and Christians, or think they're Christians, that deny the blood of Christ, change it to the death, but not the blood. If they're saved, we hope that they'll be straightened out some way. If they're lost, also, we pray they be straightened out as well on this very important subject that John MacArthur has confused many thousands and thousands all over the world with his false teaching and many other false teachings as well. Guide us who are saved and genuine Christians to be on the honor of the blood of Christ, the perfect blood of God, God's blood, from his incarnation that the Father gave to the Son of God, all of his body, including his blood. It was from the incarnation, the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus. So guide us and direct us, help us to live for him who died for us. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen. Amen. Let's take our hymnals again. And turn to hymn number 147. Number 147. Amazing grace. Let's say the verse together. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Romans 5:20. 147.